Senator McConnell has said that no bill will come to the Senate floor unless it has liability protections. And Senate Republicans have proposed limiting COVID-related liability lawsuits through 2024. The House has no such provisions. How will this be resolved?
For the most part, individuals who are receiving Social Security on pensions or government paychecks haven't really been hurt too much by the economics of coronavirus. It's people who've lost their jobs. These senators realize that one of the top things as a job killer is litigation costs that are going to come down the road, not necessarily that have already arrived.
The Democrats say, why do you need to put this kind of language in that makes all kinds of precedents without any examples of a real need? And of course, the Republicans respond with, if there isn't any need, why are you complaining so much about putting it in?
Is there some short-term liability that can be given to certain groups? And of course, those certain groups are large and small businesses, but we also see our colleges and universities.
I think this is going to end up in a compromise. I think the Republicans clearly want it for some legitimate reason. And I think Democrats want some other things like aid to state and local government. I think the issue is going to be, what's the standard? What standard do you have to adhere to in order to be eligible for this protection?
The House provides $540 billion in funding for state governments and $375 billion for local governments for a total of $915 billion. The Senate bill contains no funding for state and local governments. It was reported at one point that the White House would agree to $150 billion. How is this going to play out?
Well, this is a key priority for the Democrats, so they're going to keep pushing on this question. My expectation is it's going to come up in the neighborhood of $300 maybe $400 billion for this cause. I think the Republicans will counter by saying, well, look, there's some unused money and we're going to provide money for education in our approach. So that money for education offsets some of the state and local costs. So we don't think you need to go to nearly $1 trillion. Democrats are going to say, well, that may be true, but we certainly need a lot more than $150 billion.
I think the Republicans have to have something for state and local governments. If you think about the county jails, and obviously education is a different issue, but all the services that municipalities provide, the counties and local governments are going to have to prove that the money is for revenue shortfalls, not spending shortfalls.
But I think the money is only going to come for actual expenses related to COVID. My feeling is that it's going to be closer to the smaller side of the financial agenda rather than the larger or the higher side.
Now, I'm going to agree with Rodney. Let me tell you why. If you look at this, this is not going to be a $3 trillion bill. That's just not going to happen. I don't think it's going to be a $2 trillion bill. If you look, this is almost a third of this bill. If you slice this dollar here, you cut it down pretty close to where you're going to have to get it. I think it's going to be closer to the $150 billion provision.
Both the HEROES Act and the HEALS Act provide $1,200 stimulus checks. However, the modified Senate skinny bill proposed by Senator McConnell does not include anything for stimulus. If there is a deal, do you guys think it'll include stimulus checks?
Yes, it's going to include stimulus checks, and the reason is because it's the one thing both parties agreed in their bill. And the second thing is everybody's telling them they've got to have this by September for the economy, so I think you're going to see some kind of stimulus check provision in there.
I think there'll also be a stimulus check in there because it's good politics. But fundamentally, people need help. And if you want someone's vote, now's the time to give them some help.
I think that the push and pull here is between the stimulus checks and the surcharge, or whatever you call it, for unemployment benefits. And the Republicans really don't like the $600 additional unemployment benefit. So they might be able to be willing to give on the straight stimulus check, because after all, they have that a pretty hefty provision in their bill. But I think the two are going to be tied together.
Good politics, but I think this will be wrapped into the continuing resolution at the end of September. I don't think something will happen between now and then.
The House bill will continue the extra $600 per week federal contribution to unemployment benefits from the CARES Act, which is now expired. The Senate bill would provide $200 per week for 2 months, at which point it would be converted to 70% of lost wages. Is there a path forward on this issue?
Well, I don't think it's going to be $300 a week. I think it's going to be more than that, but I think it's definitely going to be unemployment benefits. And the reason is all three of these bodies agree on that. The White House agrees on it, the House, the Senate, that we need to have some sort of continuation of unemployment benefits. And the other thing is just the reality. As these unemployment benefits are running out and people have lost jobs and all of a sudden they're worried about foreclosures on their houses and those kind of things, the fall could be, especially October, a very, very ugly period of time economically for the country. I don't think the president wants that. I don't think senators running for re-election want that. I don't think the House members, all of whom are running for re-election, want that.
I agree with Randy's point. I think it'll be, you know, probably closer to 400, but I think there's a, it definitely, the parties have agreed that it'll be in there, but I think the amount won't be at 300.
Given the fact that the president wants a $400 number, the Senate has a lower number and the House has a slightly higher number, don't you think the president's position prevails here?
I think the concern that the Senate has is not incentivizing people not to go back to work. They want everybody to go to work. So I think if they can find a way to maybe do 70% or transition the weekly payments to 70% of earned income, I think then they will feel they have an incentive for people to go back to work, but at the same time, they don't appear heartless in terms of not giving unemployment benefits, because as has been pointed out by other folks on this panel, both sides agree that additional assistance is needed.
On education, both the House and Senate bills fund the Education Stabilization Fund for K through 12 and the Higher Education Emergency Relief Fund at a combined level of more than $100 billion. In addition, the House bill extends the CARES Act suspension of student loan payments for an additional year through 9/30/21. Is there enough common ground in here to reach a deal?
The president wants schools to open. He views that as a significant factor in opening up the economy. The schools need the aid in order to open up safely. We've had a lot of horror stories about schools opening, then closing, high infection rates among young people. So providing the school aid addresses the president's concern about getting the schools open, getting people back to work. It also addresses the Republican concern about state and local aid, because they say, well, we're giving state and local aid, we're giving it in the education arena. And so that enables them to hold down the overall number for state and local government aid at a time when Democrats are pressing to push that number higher.
Albert, that is a very good point because it ties it into the municipal aid bill. And I think it's quite likely that the idea of giving aid to education politically is a far more attractive alternative to Republicans than it would be giving aid to counties and towns for those people to spend. And that's where they may end up.
Part of this overall education package is the issue of suspending payments on student loans. And there, I think both Republicans and Democrats would be supportive of taking some action there.
Yeah, and I think one of the keys on this is going to be what the overall number of the package is. If the overall number of the package is a little bit higher, I think this is definitely in there, because as you guys have all pointed out quite accurately, this is a palpable way for Republicans to give aid to state and local governments and not have a problem or as big a problem with their base.
With respect to homeowners and renters, the House bill provides more than $200 billion, and it also extends the eviction moratorium, which expired on July 24th. President Trump signed an executive order urging the Health and Human Services Department and CDC to consider whether extending the eviction moratorium will slow the spread of COVID. But it has not stopped evictions from starting. Where do you think the middle is here?
My sense is that the middle may well be on evictions. I think both sides agree they want to prevent people from being thrown out of their houses. I think you could get an agreement on that. In terms of aid to renters, I think that's one of the areas where the Republicans are saying the Democrats are asking for too much. Democrats, on the other hand, feel people are hurting and they need this assistance.
The problem that the landlords have, however, is if you have the eviction moratorium and the additional assistance, there isn't any guarantee that renters are going to actually pay the rent. So if you give renters the assistance, you theoretically should not have the eviction prohibition or have the eviction prohibition without the rent. And I think the Republicans are going to want to know how you resolve those that sort of inconsistency.
The other thing that's really interesting here is this is one where the president doesn't care as much whether Congress acts or not, because the president's in the driver's seat a little bit. He gets to say, hey, I'm looking at executive orders. I tried to do something to help you. It was Congress that stopped and didn't do anything. So if I'm the White House, I'm saying, well, whether they get this done or not, I get to hold the Trump card on this one, no pun intended.
I want to add something on evictions, and I don't want to be a doomsayer, but I think people need to be realistic. In this climate, when you start executing evictions, it could get very dangerous. I think landlords are going to be aware, sheriffs are going to be aware of it, and heaven forbid you have a tragedy in the execution of an eviction, I think that's going to have a real consequence in terms of how people are looking at this whole political process and whether it's working for the average citizen.
And I'm surprised that there are not more stories, horror stories about people being thrown out in the street. I think the landlords obviously historically are viewed in a very negative capacity, but I do think many more of them are being very careful about the eviction.
On healthcare, the Senate provides over $100 billion for testing, tracing, vaccines, hospitals, and providers. The House bill provides almost twice this amount, plus nearly $200 billion for Heroes Fund to provide premium pay to essential workers and another $81 billion to assist states with Medicaid costs. Can a compromise be found?
I think the answer is yes. I think the reason is because, once again, this is one of those we're just arguing over dollars. We're not arguing over whether or not you differ on the issue.
There's an interesting negotiation that can occur because the business community would very much like to receive some sort of favorable tax treatment for the costs associated with COVID for essential workers. And so if you have a combination of a business credit for the business side and a direct payment to an essential worker hero payment, it may make some sense. Each would be pared down a little bit and they might go together.
It is important that when vaccines are developed, and I think the administration is taking this seriously, that those vaccines have wide distribution.
If you don't increase the testing, then you can't do the tracing. People want to fill football stadiums. People want to go back to their normal lives. You can't do that unless you can test, and you have to test in order to do the tracing. So I think there will be a push to get some money in this area simply because it's a component of opening up the economy on the large scale that we want in terms of theaters and athletic events and things of that nature.
With respect to the small business assistance, the House and Senate have significantly different approaches. Application for the PPP loan program stopped on August 8th. The House bill extends this through the end of the year and redirects remaining funds to smaller businesses. The Senate bill adds $158 billion in new funding. Under the Senate skinny proposal, these new funds would be available for PPP loans, including second draw loans for businesses that have lost more than 50% of the revenues. Can the two versions be reconciled?
See, I think so. Because it seems to me both sides are very committed to helping small businesses because they understand that that's where the pain is and that's where significant job losses are occurring. A lot of people who've been hurt are now saying, hey, this is continuing longer than we thought and this we need assistance. I think both sides will find a way to help out small business.
Yep. You look across suburban America or small-time America, a small-time town America, a lot of businesses have closed up forever. And so I think this handout will continue to be supported by both the majority and minority.
But the question is going to be, how are they going to cap this? And it gets down to the basic question. If you keep saying yes, 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 this is an important priority, you end up at $3 trillion.
And to put things into perspective, the Small Business Administration for the last 10 years only received like $3.5 billion of an annual appropriation. So this is a staggering amount of money.
I think this is a great place that they could say, wait a minute, we want to put the brakes on, make sure where this money is going is being used correctly.
The Postal Service has become increasingly high profile. The House bill provided $20 billion. The original Senate HEALS Act included nothing for the Postal Service. But recently, Senator McCown proposed a modified bill that included $10 billion for the Postal Service. Is this an issue where the two sides can agree?
I think that there's going to be additional money for the Postal Service. There's no question about that. Of course, this drops into the whole issue of the Postmaster General, the money for states that have mail-in ballots, keeping the post office working efficiently, getting a free, fair, and as accurate as possible election. So it's a messy issue.
If there's money put in there, it'll be closer to the Senate amount. There's no way on God's earth the post office is going to find any way to spend $25 billion between now and the end of the year. The
Senate's already at $10 billion, so there's going to be money to aid the post office. Now it's more of a volume concern. I think the volume concern will probably be addressed by the number that ultimately the two sides agree to so that people can accommodate the additional mail-in and absentee ballots.
Right, though, it's going to be that lower number. Yeah. There's no way in the world it's going to be a higher number. And it's going to be just so everybody can put a stamp and say we did something for the Postal Service.
So bottom line, is there going to be a deal and when?
I think at the end of September is part of the continuing resolution.
I think we will see something by the end of September because everybody's been advised and counseled how important it is to the economy to have something by that time frame.
And watch carefully for the economic statistics for the month of August, which will be released by the middle of September, because that will be a big influencer in the speed, scope, and cost of any additional COVID bills.
Charlie makes a great point. I would just add, this ultimately comes down to politics. And before an election year, you want to bring home some bacon. And this, if ever there was a need for bacon on the part of the American public, I think this is the year. So I expect something will get done.